And welcome to another edition of One on One with Dupe. This is Rick DuPree, your host here on Rainier Valley Radio, and can't tell you how pleased and honored I am to welcome Sonics legend Donald Slick Watts to the show. Slick, how you doing, man? Good to see you.
You know, Richard, anytime I hear from you is always a good day. When you called me, I had a big smile on my face, and when I left you years ago, I had a big smile on my face, and I was very happy to hear from you again.
Well, man, I appreciate you taking time out, coming here to the studio to join us live here on One on One with Dupe. And, you know, it's really exciting to have you here. I mean, I have been obviously a big fan and in the recent years, you know, working for the Sonics and what have you, become friends, get out and golf together. So it's just great to have you here. And to allow our listeners to hear from you. And again, with us not having a team, but you know, we'll get into some of that, but I really want to, really kind of go in depth and personal so people, can get a sense of who Donald Slick Watts really is. Is that all right?
Hey, Richard, that's the way we do it. You know, we've been doing it a long time and, once again, you know, back in our heydays, and I thought that it was people like you and I, and I seen the president of the Warriors. You know, when you get old, you lose your mind. You
know? I know, I'm trying to think, who is the Warriors president?
The Warriors used to be a ball boy for the Sonics.
Oh,
Rick Welch.
Yes, okay.
You know, and I think of people like him and you, and when we got it going, and we still, you know, we still around hanging and kind of keep hope alive. And you know, every time I get a chance to talk on radio or talk on TV, it's a glimmer of hopes that the Sonics, the ghost of the Sonics is still around, yeah. You know, so we keep that ghost going. So it's good to be here. And let's try to keep it alive today.
Yeah. Well, that ghost may make an appearance. Our guest is Slick Watts here, Sonics legend on One on One with Dupe on Rainier Valley Radio. And Slick, let's go back, because doing some of my research, and you know, I know you, we've talked a lot, but growing up in Mississippi, let's talk about the Deep South and take us back to those days when things first started out for you down there.
You know, Richard, I was just, funny you should ask me that question. I was out in the parking lot, you know, waiting on you just a while ago. And about six fans came by, and we got into a little recall, you know, total recall memories.
Yeah.
And they started talking about Mississippi. And they was asking me, how did I feel about some opportunities that I had missed with the World Championship? And I told them that I didn't feel bad about that, because my beginning, I was a cotton picker. And being a cotton picker, making 50 cent a day,
yeah.
66.
Yeah.
Oh, I had a hell of a career.
Yes, indeed.
I had a hell of a career, mm-hmm. being able to leave there, 66 in the hot sun.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah.
Every day, dreaming, going, coming out of the fields, watching Russell and Lenny and Elgin and Bob Pettig, Bob Cousy, Guy Rogers, watching all those guys on a little black and white TV.
Mm-hmm.
My mom and dad was rich. They had one TV, a black and white.
Uh-huh.
Everybody in the neighborhood came to that one house.
Really?
You know, they just make $50 a week. So we was considered rich with that.
Yeah.
And then we making $10 a week picking
mm-hmm.
cotton.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody used to yell in the floor and watch the pros play. And all those young guys was dreaming, you know, dreaming that one day. And now here, 43 years later, I'm sitting here talking to you, Rick, and about the Sonics, and been there and did it. And I tell you, it still feel like a dream.
Yeah.
It still feel like a dream.
Slick Watts, our guest here on One on One with Dupe. You're listening to Rainier Valley Radio. And Slick, I mean, you talk about that. I don't think kids today in particular, and especially here in the Pacific Northwest, can't relate to kind of the lifestyle of being out, you know, in the fields, picking cotton, and that type of thing. But how did that motivate you? Talk about, you know, again, you said you saw some of those other legends on the television. How did that motivate you to say, hey, I want to get out of here. I want a better life for myself.
It gave you the strength and courage to do what you need to do to get out of there. It motivated you to the point that you, you listened to your parents.
Mm-hmm.
You played ball. Football, baseball, basketball. You played all three sports. Even though I was a basketball player, we played all the sports. We start football in the morning. Then we go to baseball. And then Bo Knight, he on the basketball court.
Yeah.
Because we loved them all. We had all the dreams. Johnny Unitas, we had all the dreams. We had Willie Mays, that dream.
Yeah.
Then you had Bill Russell, that dream. So we all, the whole community, we all got together and we pretended that we was them.
Yeah.
In every sport. So we did the night and day. And what it did, it motivated us to, we didn't have corners to stand on and pants to pull down. Y'all hear me out there, kids.
Pull the pants up.
We didn't have all that. We just had sports, food, and I hate to say it, we appreciated a good dessert.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes you didn't get dessert till on weekends. So you had to get creative. Mm-hmm. You had to do the butter with sugar on bread.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yes, sir. You know? Well, I've been there. I know what you're talking about.
You know, to make your dessert.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What it gave us a sense of, hey, I got to make this work. I got to do what I need to get out of here. And it motivated you because you wanted a good life. And then once I got to college and they started paying me $15 a month, I thought I was rolling.
You were there. You made you arrived.
I thought I was rolling, Rick.
Yeah,
I thought I was rolling. And I tell kids now, you got to appreciate life and don't take things for granted. And I tell my grandbaby boy every day, I say, hey, you got all these Jordans, you got all the K's, and you got all the stepping curve shoes. They walk around with slippers in the bag. The slippers.
Slippers in the bag.
Slippers in the bag cost $190. The shoes cost $300. So when they get through playing, they put on their slippers and they put two pairs of shoes in the bag. Look, because they all get dirty.
Yeah.
And all day we just taped them up.
Yeah.
Taped them up, baby. Bad boys had a hole in them.
Yeah.
You taped them up, man, and you went to the gym. And you played like you had on $5,000 shoes.
Yeah.
You didn't know your feet even hurt.
Yeah. I know that's right. Sonics legend Slick Watts, our guest here on One-on-One with Dupe. And it's funny you mentioned that. I have family down in Arkansas. And I can remember my sister-in-law is in Humphrey, Arkansas.
Yeah,
and Humphrey, tell you what, you're driving on the road and you blink and you've gone through Humphrey. But we would go down there was one hoop in the town there, and my sister-in-law put it up and her two boys, and initially it was on, like, you know, a little dirt and what have you, and they finally got it paved and what have you, but you know, all the kids would be there playing, and it's a whole different, like you talked about, that motivation to just excel.
Whole different appreciation. It's a whole different, didn't know what, during the little hot weather we get here in Seattle, they say, oh, it's hot outside. Oh man, we didn't know how hot it was.
Yeah.
We all looked like we was from Africa. We look real African. We played in the sun all day. And I had a friend like mine named Carl C. Frazier. God bless his soul. He's going to heaven now. But we used to play 37 games a day. You know, not really 72, because we wouldn't stop till he had 30 wins and I have 30 wins. And we would play who's going to win the last one.
Yeah.
Every day.
One-on-one.
And he helped me make pro, because when I got to college, I could go one-on-one.
Mm-hmm.
So every day I played 6 or 7 a game.
Yeah.
Because that's all we had.
Yeah.
Mama would make you get those books. Hey, she was serious. She was a teacher. So the books were serious. You played, but you came and you got the books.
Yeah.
And one thing they didn't play, you had to take a bath.
Yeah. You can't go around smelling. Oh, Lord, no. And you better have some clean underwear on, too. Come on. Yeah.
And then you had two pair of jeans.
Mm-hmm.
Rick, you have two pair of jeans sometime. And you play church football or football at school. And man, you sit at the water fountain with a towel and try to get that green stain out of them, because when you get home, you had to have your jeans clean.
Or else you're getting a whooping, boy. Yeah, I know that's right. Man, bring back some memories of the days. Sonics legend Slick Watts, our guest here on One-on-One with Dupe. And talk a little bit about your high school career. And nowadays, I mean, you see these high schoolers, it started, LeBron, I think, really brought it to another level. But you were starting to see somewhere, you know, these high schoolers, you're seeing them on TV and the national rankings and all of that. But talk about your high school career and that recruitment process, if you were recruited and what that was like.
Well, see, the thing that we didn't have, the opportunity to have the rankings what we did, for example, A grade, I started on my high school team because I had put so many hours playing one-on-one in middle school. So I was able to start and play A grade. And I often tell friends that I was a lot like Stephen Curry. I just shot. I shot from everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't care. I could make it too because I had that confidence. But, you know, after I got to college, I met Bob Hopkins, and he was a big guy. He didn't play that. He didn't play little guys shooting the ball a lot. So I had to learn to play defense. But when I was growing up in Mississippi, all we did, man, was just play hoop, mm-hmm. hoop. And, you know, take care of your business at, with your mom and schoolwork.
Mm-hmm.
Come in 9 o'clock, take that bath and do the same thing every day and prepare for college. And you had to make sure that they started the SAT test.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, back in those days. And with the SAT test, you had to prepare to pass that, you know, and they should get counseling. And how do you pass the SAT test?
Mm-hmm.
That's one of those things was big back in our days. And we wouldn't worry about so much the rankings and the traveling and the AAU. You know, we didn't have that. We just had backyard.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Scoop the cow poo out the way. Because you might be dribbling and boop all in your face and don't make a mistake and lick your tongue out.
You're
in trouble. So
So
we laugh about those days because it made us what we were and then what we became. And it molded me into a hard worker. And it got me ready for whatever happened in my life.
Yeah.
And when I met guys like Bill Russell, for example, he couldn't understand why he couldn't rally me, you know, because
mm-hmm.
if that cat feel don't rally you.
Yeah.
Look, nothing could rally you from 6-6 in the outside.
Yeah. Well, you're dribbling and pooping and everything.
Yeah.
No, that's right.
He used to look at me and say, "Boy, why are you on blank when I look at you?" I say, I ain't scared of you, man. I've been being gotten all my life.
Yeah.
But he was funny that way. He always wanted you to drop his head mm-hmm, and talk to him, mm-hmm. you know. But coming up, man, has just taught me how to just deal with it and appreciate it.
Yeah.
And now at 65, I still appreciate it. And I get mad at my grandbaby sometimes because he get a little cocky. I say, "Boy, you just don't know how good you got it, you know." And he wear a pair of shoes twice and say, "Papa, they too tight, you know." And I guess the reason my feet didn't grow no more, because after I got my first pair of shoes, mama made me wear them 10 years.
Our guest is Sonics legend Donald Slick Watts here on One-on-One with Dupree. You're listening to Rainier Valley Radio. And Slick, talk about the journey to Xavier. So you went from Mississippi and then you head over to New Orleans. But talk about that journey and how you got to Xavier.
You know, Rick, that's a very interesting story. I was sitting at home, really into the Final Four,
mm-hmm.
and Drake University was playing UCLA, and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, before he was named.
Yeah, Lou Alcindor.
That's what he was then. He was playing against a guy named Willie McCarter. And Willie McCarter was about 6'2", 6'3", my size or taller, but he was a good little guard. And UCLA beat them by 2 points. And I was sitting at home at that black-white TV with 50 people around watching that final game. And 2 hours after, I almost fainted. Coach Marvin John from Drake University, who just lost by 2 points from UCLA, called Slick Watts and said, "I heard you can play. I got a ticket for you to come up here." Man, I jumped and I shouted. Oh, man. After watching the NCAA.
Yeah. And right after the game, well, you called me.
2 hours after the game, I get a phone call. Say, "I heard a lot about you. I heard that you can shoot in the dark." He said, "I heard you can shoot in the dark." That he said. That's his quote. And I said, "What time, what bus, what plane you want me to get on?" I was ready to go. So I packed up and went to Drake University. Got up there and found out that there were some great players there. And secondly, they didn't play freshmen, could play. And I didn't know that because I was always a player. I want to play.
Mm-hmm. You want to be on the bench, huh? Yeah.
You know, yeah. Freshmen can play.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not on the bench, you couldn't play.
Yeah.
You just come there and get your schoolwork.
Right.
And redshirt.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, "Boy, I didn't know that."
Mm-hmm.
So I stuck around for about 4 months. And then Coach Hopkins left Alcorn and went to Xavier University. He said, "Boy, I heard you redshirting up there." I said, Coach, I ain't liking this a bit. And I said, you know what thing, Coach, it's snowing up here too. It's cold. I mean, it was cold, man. Yeah. You could spit and your coat would freeze when it hit the ground.
Oh my goodness.
It was cold in the wintertime. Yeah. So he called me and said, you know what? I got a scholarship down here at Xavier University, close to your home. And I did something wrong. I took the coach's car because he loved me. And I took his car. I drove it to the airport. I left that bad boy running.
I got no, you
that,
didn't.
I left it running and got on that plane. Look here. Got on that plane. I was gone.
You didn't look back, huh? Look,
when they stopped in Minnesota, the changed flights, I thought the police would come and get me for leaving the car. But I just did it. I just left it running.
Yeah, yeah.
And I wanted to get out of there.
Oh, my goodness.
So I flew on to New Orleans, and that's I ended up at Xavier University.
Yeah.
From there. And I got there and met Hopkins, and I was around different groups of people. Mm-hmm. More people are, as they say, shades of black and white and red and yellow and green.
A little bit more color there.
Yeah,
huh?
Around all colors there.
Yeah.
Nons and everything. Mm-hmm. And I fell in love with the school, and that was my story to get into Xavier University. And it was the best time of my life.
Yeah.
Before I got up here.
Sonics legend Slick Watts, our guest here. You're listening to Rainier Valley Radio. This is One-on-One with Dupree. I'm Rick Dupree, your host. And now, talk about your career at Xavier. And at what point, and maybe when you first got there, and that was always your vision, but at what point did you, I would imagine the goal was to get to the NBA, but at what point did you say, okay, I'm on a path here. I think this is going to work out. I think I'm going
to
make it.
Well, you know, Rick, I always wanted to be a shortstopper and a base pitcher,
mm-hmm.
because I had quick hands, and my dad was better than Willie Mays. He was, matter of fact, he could really play.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved baseball, but it was too slow and didn't want to attend your game, but your mama and your dad, and they flip heads to tail who's going
who's gonna go, huh?
Because one day I go, I'm gonna stay at home.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They would never both go.
Right.
It's your turn.
Yeah, yeah.
So baseball was a good game, but it's always boring to my family. My family loved basketball. So I practiced hard every day, and Coach Hopkins was hard on me, you know, because I, like I said, I was like Stephen Curry. I used to shoot. Mm-hmm. I didn't think there was a shot in the world I couldn't take. Mm-hmm. And sometimes 90% I would make, but Hopkins didn't play that. He was a coach. And he was trying to get to the NBA too. And he wanted the world to know he could coach. He didn't want a little knucklehead coming down and shoot 80 foot and tell me he called that play. So he kind of broke me down and taught me how to play defense. And a friend of mine, not a friend of mine, but he got to be a friend of mine now. His name was Jimmy Jones. He was all pro from the Washington Bullets, 6'5" guard, and just made all pro. And he came to visit our campus. And he needed a workout friend. And he blooded my nose every day for about 2 months. I mean, he beat me down.
Mm-hmm.
And then one day I learned. I started to learn how to study things. I started watching him play. And then about 2 weeks later, me and him, we get real fighting. Because I started wearing his butt out. You know,
I started.
And he was all pro,
mm-hmm.
you know, all pro in the NBA. So I started wearing him down. And then he'll call me sometime, but I got so he didn't want to play me too much more because he found out I could play.
Yeah, you don't want to take that beat down. Huh? Yeah.
I had learned how to, you know, get out of the way and strip him and
right. Take
balls like I do. And he taught me how to be good, Jimmy Jones. And then Hopkins saw me playing one day. He said, goddamn boy, I think you ready. I said, Coach, you think I'm ready? He said, yeah, I think you're ready. He said, I'm going to call Hop. Russell.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to call Russ. And he called Russ, and Russ got on the phone, and Russ say, boy, I heard you kicking Jimmy Jones' butt. Can you play? And I said, man, if you can coach, I can play. And you know Russ, that messed with his head.
Yeah, yeah.
He said, okay, I'm going to give you a ticket. One way. He said, if you don't make it, you got to pay your way back home.
Oh, my goodness.
And so, man, I left. I sold every little thing I had. And when I got through selling everything I had and paying my bills off, I got on the plane with 37 cents, a big old hat on my head, and some slippers on my feet. And I told everybody I wasn't coming back home.
Mm-hmm.
That was 44 years ago. I still haven't came back
home.
Yeah, I came up here and met the great Fabulous Bill Russell, as, mm-hmm, called, mm-hmm. as he called himself, and everybody called him too.
That's all right. Slick Watts, Sonics legend, our guest here on One-on-One with Dupe. And you make the move to Seattle, and you know, what went through your mind when the draft went through and you were undrafted?
Oh, that's a funny story. I like that one. That's mm-hmm. a real funny story, mm-hmm. too, because, you know, a dummy like I think I was at that time. I was smart in school, but I took things for granted sometime, and I didn't think. I thought on the basketball floor and baseball floor, but I didn't think in reality sometime. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I thought the reason I didn't get drafted first, because my name started with a W. You know, that's pretty bad.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I thought, oh, this, you know, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. I said, they ain't drafting me because my name started with a W. I'm going to be close to Z.
Yeah, yeah.
Then they drafted a boy named Zanos.
Before you,
I said, oh, shit.
A reality set in, huh?
They must have when I said ABC. Yeah. So, seriously, I actually thought the draft was going on alphabet.
Yeah, yeah.
And I sit there in that time, Picayune, for about 3 hours. And boy, my head dropped. And I said, well, boy, I guess I'm going to be a firefighter, a policeman, what I dreamed of being. You know, I wanted to be a firefighter, a policeman, cycling. In my life, I always tell kids, I always have 4 or 5 goals. That's the important things in life. Always give yourself a chance to fail and feel good about what did you pick up in life.
Mm-hmm.
So I, you know, for a minute I put my head down, but I said, well, I'm gonna try to be a fireman, you know, a policeman. And then when Russell got the call from Hopkins, say, I got this kid, he didn't get drafted, but he can play. I see him beat Jimmy Jones every day, 1-on-1. And Russell brought me on up.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a story in itself, too. But it was tough to sit there in that newspaper. I went down to Time Picayune and sit there in a chair.
Yeah.
And watched the board. And I was waiting for the W's to come
mm-hmm.
up.
W's didn't come up. What's up?
W's didn't come up.
You know, it was interesting. I mean, not like today where everything's televised. You got every pick and what have yeah. you. So you sitting there and waiting for the news to come across the wire or something,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
yeah. yeah.
Coach from Cleveland, Cavanier, I forget his name, but he had told me that he liked me. And I was hoping when they had a draft, my name came up, but it didn't come up there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I saw, you know, but I still was hoping for W's.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Well, finally came around.
Z came around.
Z came before W.
Oh, no more alphabet.
Our guest here on One-on-One with Dupe is Sonics legend Slick Watts. You're listening to a Rainier Valley Radio. And Slick, that's a funny story,
no,
man.
True,
I tell you. Yeah,
no
yeah.
More
oh, my God. So let's talk now. You get here to Seattle and a very different environment. The weather's different. Talk about that transition for you. And now, as you said, you've made it home 40 plus years later, but that initial getting off that plane and coming here, and what you remember what was going through your mind at that time?
Well, it was strange. It was strange in a way because, first of all, I didn't have nowhere to stay. And they had brought me up early. And, you know, God bless the good white folks in America. I met a white family.
Uh-huh.
That was Sonics fan,
mm-hmm.
and this took to me, and let me stay with him 2 months.
Wow.
Free,
yeah, oh,
free,
my God,
2 months.
Yeah,
brother from the neighborhood, way down in the south, staying with a white family, and then camp started,
mm-hmm.
and then I could leave their house, and we went to Port Angeles. But before we went to Port Angeles, we stayed at this little hotel still down there on 6th Street, and they had the meeting in my room with all 62. Players that had been drafted, and I'm known a free agent, and they had a meeting in my room.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting there on my bed, and all these big people come in my room.
Mm-hmm.
I never seen so many big people in my life.
Yeah,
I mean real big.
Yeah.
I went, God, this is who I got to play against?
Mm-hmm.
I mean big people, 6 of them.
Yeah.
So we get on the bus and you go to Port Angeles, and then the real big people show up.
Oh, those were the bigger ones,
oh,
huh?
Spencer Haywood.
Oh, okay.
Jim McDaniel.
Oh.
John Brisker. The little Afro Rand Fred Brown.
Yeah.
All of them who had the lights laid out cars.
Yeah.
And then 3 or 4 girls driving up in the car.
Yeah.
I'm peeping out the window. Like little kids. Just, oh, it's Spencer drive up in a big green long Cadillac. John drives in a nice pretty black Mercedes. And I said, oh, this is what you do if you make it.
Yeah.
I said nothing. Just looking out the window.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to me, it's a motion picture.
Yeah.
But we getting ready to go to camp. I'm getting ready to go to camp with all these guys that four of them's making $4 million. Mm. You know, so they was guaranteed a spot.
Right.
So they drove up last. And all those rookies was on the bus watching them get on. They get five and they hug him.
Yeah.
So everybody was quiet. I don't know, Rick was just quiet, like, you know, Santa Claus was in the house at the time.
you can't wake up Santa.
Here.
Yeah.
And all the big timers, they get in there, they talk and they play backgammon and they talk all the way to Port Angeles, and we get in the hotel and they put Rookie Street to a room and the fight starts. You know, we start trying to make survival.
Yeah.
Survival.
Yeah.
Survival. I was a big timer though. I was the last one standing. And that was a long trip too, boy, I tell you. We was talking about in the paper today about the fight.
Mm-hmm.
John Brisker and my boy, they got to fight in my rookie season.
Mm-hmm.
And that was scary, you know, to know that I'm playing as a guy can break a man's jaw. And he was playing big guard. Sometimes I switch on him.
Yeah, and I was aggressive. Yeah.
But when I got to him, I was like, hands back. So that was a trip also. But it was a fun experience and one that I'll never forget.
Yeah. No, I just actually read the article. I think it's Jason Jenks did, both on you, but then on John Brisker. Our guest is Sonics legend Slick Watts here on One-on-One with Dupe. You're listening to Rainier Valley Radio. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, want to get a little bit more about that first training camp for Slick. And then also historic season where Slicky led the NBA in both assists and steals. And just a great season there. And then I want to talk a little bit more about, or I shouldn't say a little bit more, but I want to talk a little bit about today's players and kind of comparison and kind of get your take on that. Again, our guest is Slick Watts, Sonics legend, right here on One-on-One with Dupe. You're listening to Rainier Valley Radio. We'll be back in just a moment.